Thank you.
I like that song.
Yeah.
A lot. A lot. A lot. You guys look good tonight.
Thank you.
There's definitely like we're heavy on this side over here, and
that's not nice.
Wow. Don't personalize everything you say, huh? Holy cow. Haven't you heard the second agreement? Second agreement. Don't take anything personal.
Oh, that's the second time I've heard that this week.
We're the same person.
Oh, amen. Weird. Weird, right? So I do like that song, and I told Beth I like that song a lot. I especially like that song in the series that we're in on Jesus' miracles. So I like it a lot. So it probably will happen again and again. Announcements! Ready, Mayor?
Yep.
All right, here we go. Oh, we're doing that.
Tomorrow's
the second day, and yes, the last day. Today was the first day. Tomorrow's the last day. Anyway. We interacted with Baca today, and they are having their anniversary party on April 16th. That is the day before Easter at Murray Street Arts. So if you're interested in supporting them, do you guys know who Baca is? Bikers Against Child Abuse?
Yep.
Okay. All right. Sometimes I just use a whole bunch of acronyms, and then I wonder if anybody knows what they mean. Anyway, is everybody tired?
Yes.
Okay. That's why you're not really... audience participation tonight. Okay. Next, we are having a yard sale. We already talked about that. Yeah. Are we Facebook Live?
Yeah.
Hi, Facebook. Is Roxy there? We are having a yard sale. We were talking about that earlier. If you're on Facebook Live and you have stuff that you want to donate to the yard sale, please get it to us as soon as possible or let me know that somebody needs to pick it up or something. April 22nd and 23rd, all of the proceeds from the yard sale are going to help us to beautify Circle Drive this summer. That's our second project. Our first project, we are shoulder deep in work in that basement right now. Next, Car and Bike Show, April 23rd. And that, again, is at Murray Street Arts. Do you guys know that Murray Street Arts is now owned by one of the Street Envy chicks?
Really?
So, yeah. So, Hazel from Street Envy has Murray Street Arts now, so a lot of stuff is happening over there, which is awesome. International Ride Day on May 7th. I don't have more details on that yet, but I'm sure I will soon. Vets for Vets Spring Party. That is May 7th. We will go after church that night up to the ALR post on Janine, which is just on North Academy, just a little bit past North Carefree. And we are selling tickets for that freezer full of meat. So if you're interested in those, $10 a ticket. The blessing of the bikes. Gosh, I hope the basement's done.
By the way, that begins here.
The blessing of the bikes begins
it
here?
It starts here at this church.
Weird.
1318
here?
North Circle.
Weird. We better not be tired that day. We're going to be tired that night. Anyway, if you've never been to the Blessing of the Bikes or you don't know about the Blessing of the Bikes, Facebook Live, or anybody that's visiting us tonight, that event, there are a lot of events that are a Blessing of the Bikes, right? And it's a place for you to go and get your bike blessed and get you blessed, right? Because there's that. We don't just bless motorcycles. However, there are events that are really, better just come get your bike blessed and off you go. This is not that event. This event, so really when we're sharing this with our friends and our family and the general public, we have to help people understand that this event is, yes, you can come and get prayed over and we pray over the riding season and all of that, but this event is an all-day event that helps us raise our annual Biker Benevolence Fund, which we then use throughout the year to help bikers that go down, that have cancer, that lose jobs, that for whatever reason need financial assistance. And so this event is more than just coming to get your bike prayed over. So sometimes people say, all right, I had my bike prayed over last year. I'm like, well, A, whatever. Anyway, If you want to register in advance, you can, so that you have more money the day of. Like, if you have money now and you want to spend it, you can register now. And then you'll have more money the day of, because we've got, thanks to Jenny and her team, huge amounts of raffle items and auction items and other things. And, yeah, so on our postcard, there's a QR code. You can just scan it. It'll take you to the website. You can register on the interactive form, and then you can donate through our PayPal account, or you can register here in person any Saturday night, however you want to do that. What's next? Oh, that! So the day after our Blessing of the Bikes, on June 5th, is the spring run for Bikers United for America. And Jim Ware donated that eagle to that event to raise money for that event as well. So tickets for that are $10 each, or $7 for $50. And I do have those tickets. And the Bikers United has a booth at the event this weekend also. So you can buy tickets at the booth if you want to do that. And they're going to have a chance drawing for that. Ways to give for those of you on PayPal, you can go, or on Facebook Live, I am tired. On Facebook Live, you can go to ppbikerschurch@outlook.com, or you can visit the website, and there's a donate button on the website. Swag? All of our swag's at Swap Meet. Don't ask me for anything. Unless you want a long sleeve shirt that you can cut the sleeves off of. Already did that tonight. Okay, is that it?
That's it.
Yay! All right, very good. So tonight, and I am in the Amplified Bible, so if you have a Bible app and you want to join me in the Amplified version, you can just switch your version to Amplified. So it might not sound exactly like whatever version you have in your hands, but I am going to read from Matthew this evening. And I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 4 and from Matthew chapter 8. So Matthew chapter 4, verses 23 to 25, and he, Jesus, went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the good news, the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness among the people, demonstrating and revealing that he was indeed the promised Messiah. So the news about him spread throughout all Syria, and they brought to him all who were sick, those suffering with various diseases and pains, those under the power of demons and epileptics, paralytics, and he healed them. Large crowds followed him from Galilee and the Decapolis and Jerusalem and Judea and the other side of the Jordan. And then moving into chapter 8, verses 1 through 17. When Jesus came down from the mountain, large crowds followed him, and a leper came up to him and bowed down before him, saying, "Lord, if you are willing, you are able to make me clean. You are able to make me well." Jesus reached out his hand and touched him, saying, "I am willing. Be cleansed." Immediately his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus said to him, "See that you tell no one about this, but go show yourself to the priest for inspection and present the offering that Moses commanded as a testimony, as evidence to them of your healing." As Jesus went into Capernaum, and a centurion came up to him, begging him for help and saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed with intense and terrible tormenting pain." And Jesus said to him, "I will come and heal him." But the centurion replied to him, "Lord, I am not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man subject to authority of higher rank, with soldiers subject to me. And I say to one, go, and he goes, and I say to another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, I say, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed and said to those who were following him, "I tell you truthfully, I have not found such great faith as this with anyone in Israel. I say to you that many Gentiles will come from the east and the west and will sit down to feast at the table and enjoy God's promises with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, because they accepted me as Savior, while the sons and heirs of the kingdom, the descendants of Abraham, who will not recognize me as Messiah will be thrown out into the utter darkness. In that place, which is farthest removed from the kingdom, there will be weeping and sorrow and in pain and grinding of teeth and distress and in anger. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, it will be done for you as you have believed. And the servant was restored to health at that very hour. This is God's word. Father God, I thank you now for the opportunity to address your people. Father, I thank you for the people that are in this church, those that are on Facebook Live. Lord, I ask that minds would be open and spirits would be willing to receive your truth, your hope, your encouragement, your promise, your correction. Lord, I pray that everyone that you have brought here this evening would receive exactly what it is that they need to receive, and that they would not only receive it, but that they would bind it to their hearts, their minds, and their souls, and that it would leave this place with them. Father, I pray that we would not just be people that hear the word, but that we would be doers of the word as well. And Lord, I ask that you would increase as I decrease now before you, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The enemy continues to lie to humanity, and the enemy is always trying to convince us that we are empty, that we are broken, that we are worthless, that we are unrighteous, that we are guilty, that we are sick, that we are dead, that we are hopeless and full of despair. The enemy's job is to constantly and consistently convict us. It's the one job he has. What do I always say? The enemy has one job. What is it?
To
screw with you. Right? What is our one job? To fight back with God's word. To fight back with the name of Jesus. To constantly and consistently remind him that we are not empty, we are not broken, we are not unrighteous. We are not perpetually sick, guilty, dead, or hopeless. We are blood-bought, blood-washed children of the Most High God. Amen? Amen. So, his job is to constantly remind us of the failure in the garden and the continuing failure of life. Satan is a punk. Satan is a punk, right? And punks and bullies, they do what they do, right? They constantly try to stand and puff themselves up. They constantly try to intimidate us, right? But he's a punk. He's a bully. Our God is a righteous God. Our Savior is a loving Savior. He is a merciful Savior. He is a forgiving Savior. He has made us righteous in Christ. The miracles of Jesus, and as I have prepared these messages, and I've spent time in the miracles of Jesus, the other thing that I have spent time in this past week is that series, The Chosen. And if you haven't watched it, you need to watch it. Right? But I have spent time in this, and the thing that just continues to show up for me is that Jesus' miracles are representations of our salvation hope. That is what they are for us. They show us Jesus' presence in humanity's frustrated experience. You guys ever frustrated?
No.
Ever? Just a little frustrated? A little frustrated? Sometimes? Right? Humanity is frustrating. Right? Life is frustrating. But Jesus' presence is in that frustration. He is always present. His righteousness is present. His healing is present. His cleansing is present in our frustration. His acceptance of us is present in our frustration. His willingness, his compassion. All of these things we see in his miracles, all of these things are his presence in our lives. The things that we need from our Savior are the very embodiment of his miracles. And so I pray as we continue to move through these, that we will look at his miracles and that we will see that Jesus Christ, our Jesus Christ, is radically, you guys, radically, he is radically generous. He is radically compassionate. He is radically honoring of our human existence. Not just a little bit. He is radically respectful of all human beings in their suffering. He is a savior of equality. He has the same amount of love, mercy, grace, compassion, forgiveness for everyone. There is not one person that he loves more. And we all like to say, not all of us, some of us, especially David Joseph, likes to say, I'm his favorite. No, you're not. I'm his favorite. And Beth is his favorite. And Mary is his favorite. Right? Even William is his favorite. I just saw an opportunity. We are all his favorite.
Good job,
David. He loves every single one of us the same. Every single one of us. The miracles of Jesus Christ are the foreground for salvation. They are what he laid out in the foreground before he introduced salvation to the world. His miracles are the introduction of our Savior to us. There is no accident that the miracles happened in the foreground of that, right? And as we explore these two miracles tonight, right, large crowds were following him. I try to picture that, and as I watched The Chosen, it like came into focus for me, like,
yeah,
how large those crowds were that were following him. Now, are you guys familiar with leprosy? Because if you're not, I'm Valerie.
That's not it.
That's not it. That was funny, but that's not it, giggles. A leper, you guys, a leper makes it to him. Large crowds were following him. And a leper, whose body parts are trying to fall off, right? Who has sores on his body beyond belief. A leper makes it to him. A leper makes it to him. And that leper, who nobody wants, I mean, when a leper shows up, everybody's like,
yeah.
Right? Right? Like, whoa. And the leper says, Lord, Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean. If you are willing, you can make me clean. And what is Jesus' reply to this leper? That nobody wants to be anywhere near. Jesus is like, come here. I am willing. I am willing. I am willing. You guys, Jesus is always willing. We are all lepers. Every single one of us. I have felt like a leper. I don't know how many times in my lifetime I have felt like a leper. I'm not anywhere near worthy to get anywhere near Jesus, right? I'm not anywhere near worthy to have God, like, pay attention to me, the jerk I'm being, or have been. But he is always willing. He is always willing to reach out and touch us like he did the leper. The question for us is, are we willing? Right? That's the question. The question is, are we willing to push our way to Jesus? Are we willing to move through the crowd to get anywhere near our Savior? Are we willing to continue to seek him and find him? He's not hiding. He's not missing. He's not unwilling. Are we willing to insist on talking to him? to absolutely insist on talking to him. That's the question we have to ask ourselves. Are we willing? Are we willing to give up Saturday night?
Even when we're tired.
Right? To come seek him in church. Are we willing to reach out? I pray that we're always willing. Because his answer is always the same. I am. I am willing. And immediately, he is available. Just like he was with that leper. Next, we turn to this centurion, right? So this centurion shows up and asks Jesus for help. Lord, my servant is paralyzed and suffering. And Jesus' reply, I will come. I will come and I will heal him, right? And Jesus was headed to this house. He was going to go to this house of this centurion, right? This Roman centurion. This house that he should not be allowed in, right? Jesus is like, yeah, I'll come. Amen. Sure, let's go. You think your house, you think he's not allowed in your house? You think he can't come to your house? You think he shouldn't be there? You think he can't come into your world? You think your world's too dirty for him to come there? I'll come. The centurion says, I'm not worthy to have you come to my house. I am absolutely not worthy to have you come under my roof. And what is Jesus' reply in verses 10 through 13? When Jesus heard this, he was amazed, and he said to those who were following him, I tell you truthfully, I have not found such great faith with anyone in Israel. I say to you that many will come from the east and the west and will sit down to feast at the table and enjoy God's promises with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. While the sons and heirs of the kingdom will be thrown out into utter darkness in that place, there will be weeping and gnashing and grinding of teeth. Then Jesus said to the centurion, go, it will be done for you as you have believed. And the servant was restored to health at that very hour. This centurion knows that Jesus can handle this, right? But first, the centurion and Jesus both acknowledge Jesus' absolute authority. This centurion realizes, knows that this man, Jesus, has absolute authority. This man, this centurion, he has absolute authority in this community, right? He's the one that can make people this and make people that and make people the other thing. But this centurion realizes that Jesus Christ has absolute authority. I know you can. And I'm not worthy. I have men under me and I can make them do, but I am not worthy for you to come and do this. And Jesus recognizes his absolute authority as well, right? Jesus held authority over the centurion. Jesus held authority over everything. Jesus was blown away that this centurion had that much faith. Jesus is always excited about our faith. He's always excited to see us have faith. Always excited to see us have faith. Jesus, in this miracle, demonstrated his omnipresence. We hear that word, right? He demonstrated in this miracle, right after he touched the leper and healed the leper, he demonstrates in this miracle, he didn't have to touch anything. He didn't have to be there. He didn't have to go to the house. He didn't have to leave town. He didn't have to do anything. He is present everywhere.
Amen.
He can make things happen from way over there. He is capable of healing this servant from far away. He didn't have to travel to him. He didn't have to know where he was. He didn't have to touch him. He didn't have to speak over him. He can do anything he wants from anywhere he wants, at any time he wants, in any way that he wants. All he had to do was say to this centurion, it's done. Your servant is well. Christ demonstrates his divine authority, you guys, in this miracle over our physical selves. He has the absolute ability to make it all better. He can do anything. Like a parent that says to a small child, let me blow on that and make it better for you. Right? Has Jesus ever blown on something for you and made it all better? You know, he has blown on my wounds and made them all better in moments that I didn't think that my wounds could be made better. He especially does that for me in emotional wounds. Jamie, it's done. You're healed. It's better. Our Heavenly Father can restore us and make us complete as only the God of the universe can do for us. Will we acknowledge his presence in every corner of our lives? Also in this miracle, we hear Jesus say that many will come from the east and from the west, and many will come and take their place at the feast. You know, unfortunately, you guys, many will come to Jesus' feast and only eat crumbs. What Jesus has to offer us is this feast, this table of plenty. And he invites all of us to come and sit at that table and feast with him. And that means draw from every corner of everything that he has to offer us. And there are people that will only come and eat crumbs. Like dogs. They'll just sit under the table and take whatever's left over. Sit at the table with your Savior and eat from the feast everything that he has to offer you. All of it. Not just scraps. Jesus says that many will come and will sit down and feast and enjoy God's promises. And this, you guys, when he says that many Gentiles, right? Not just the Jews, not just the promised people, not just the chosen people. All people will come. From the east and from the west, from all over the place. And you guys, what this is saying to us is that we are all equal. We are all equal in salvation. We are all equal in healing. Not only did God respond to a Gentile centurion, heal a Gentile servant that he had never even met, but then he states that everyone can come to him. You guys, he was really upsetting people as he ran around with these pie-in-the-sky promises that everyone can come to the Messiah. But everyone can come to him. Not just some. Finally, what does it take to be saved? What does it take to be healed? What does it take to experience Christ in your life? It takes faith. It just takes faith.
Amen.
Nothing else. People from all over came to see him. Crowds of all kinds. People from everywhere came to see him. Especially the imperfect people came to see him. Especially the broken people came to see him. Especially the lepers came to see him. The blind, the lame. Especially those people came to see him. In this world that we're in, we are all those imperfect people. And this is something that just absolutely, you guys, it drives me absolutely nuts. Some people think that they can be saved by being the right person, by being the right kind of person, by being the best behaved person, by being the one that goes to church often enough, and does enough Bible studies, and witnesses to enough people, and does enough community service, or the right race, or they're Baptist, or they're Presbyterian, or they're Catholic, or they're Lutheran, or they're whatever, and whatever, right? Why doesn't God's word prove to us that everyone is equal? How is it that we can manage to get into this book that is all about equality of salvation and pick and choose and separate and divide and try to... Who are those people anyway? Did Jesus ever once have a those people moment? Those people aren't good enough. Those people have the wrong sin. Those people don't do enough of the right things. Who are those people? Those people are the ones that are going to get caught in this gnashing of teeth place that he's talking about. There is not one person that is worthy of Christ. Not one. The good news is, we don't have to be worthy. He is worthy.
Amen.
He is worthy. Those that think they're worthy, they're lost already. The religious, which is why I have that tattoo on my wrist, right? Jesus brought the Spirit. I am spiritual. I am not religious. The religious were standing with their scrolls and their big hats, thinking they knew everything. We need to be careful that we're not standing with our scrolls and our big hats and our egos. We don't want to be lost already. Those that understand that faith, trust, and the ability to surrender to Jesus Christ are the only things that get us to salvation, those are blood-bought, blood-washed children of the Most High God. Those are the people that are going to be able to make a difference in this world to the lepers, to the broken, to the unrighteous, to the hopeless, to the worthless, to the rest of humanity that is still being bullied by Satan the punk. Mm-hmm. We have to be able to show up to the lepers, you guys. We have to be humble. And we have to demonstrate our faith to this lost and dying generation. And we have to help that lost and dying generation know that there's one thing that gets them, Jesus. It's faith. It's faith, and it's an invitation. So tonight, and I don't always do this, but tonight I want to pray with you all. And if you've prayed the prayer, then you don't have to pray again. If you prayed the prayer and you want to pray again, pray again. If you don't know what the heck I'm talking about, there's a prayer. It's simple. It's just an invitation for Jesus Christ to be your Jesus, to touch your wounds, to heal your servant, and to allow yourself to become his servant. Amen?
Amen.
I want to say this before I pray this, and that is, I am so, so proud of this church. Bikers Church is just an amazing group of broken humans that love an amazing group of broken humans. So I am excited to lead this church. I am grateful that God gave me you. and not anybody else. I'll take everybody else, but, and the way that we minister to people at community outreach events like the SWAT meet, I just love the way that you guys love people. So thank you for serving our Jesus the way that you do. So if you'll pray with me. And if you've never prayed this prayer before, and you pray it tonight, and you want to share that with me, great. I chatted with somebody earlier today. I think we might be coming up on more baptisms. So if you've prayed this prayer before and you're ready to be baptized, let me know. Father God, I thank you for the opportunity tonight to look at what you have done with us as broken humans. Thank you for sending Jesus Christ into this world to walk among us and to show us his radical love for humanity and to introduce to us your love and mercy in amazing, amazing ways through his miracles. And Father, we are all that leper. We are all that broken human that we just don't feel worthy. Thank you for introducing yourself to us, Jesus, in such a powerful way. You are not afraid to touch us with our wounds, with our brokenness. You are not afraid to reach out and say, I am willing. Be cleansed. And so tonight, we say in this prayer, Jesus Christ, I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you came to this earth for me, a sinner, a leper, a broken human that has no opportunity to redeem myself on my own. I believe that you are the Son of God and that you died for my sins, that your blood was shed for my salvation hope. I believe that you died, that you were buried, and that you rose again, and that you ascended to heaven, and that you sit at the right hand of God the Father. And I believe that you did all of that for me. And because I believe that, I receive you as my Lord and Savior. And I ask you to reign on the throne of my heart. I ask you to give me the power to share my salvation hope with others. And I ask, Lord, that you would help me to be merciful with other sinners that are just like me, that believe that they are too broken and too full of leprosy to have you touch them. I ask that you would give me the boldness of spirit to share your love with others. And Lord, I thank you for being my Jesus. I thank you for my salvation. And Holy Spirit, I thank you that you continue to walk with me and guide me and direct me and encourage me. And so I acknowledge the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And I thank you for my salvation. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.